All right. Hello, everyone. This is kind of an anti question. I hope you guys heard of DeepStream. This is more than usual, actually. And
it's not surprising. We're a bit of a strange bunch. We're comparable to GraphQL, I suppose. So for a similar problem, we provide a backend as a service, but for a different group in the end. We're creating a real-time network, a global one, and in a strange way, quite successfully so actually. We've now become the data fabric that connects lots of the world's biggest investment banks with each other, that connects a lot of the ticket sales in the world with each other. And it's one of these things that stick deep in the underground. So rather than actually showing you too much of how the code works or anything, let me show you a few examples. Who of you is familiar with Ethereum? Dears, I mean, for tech meetup, this is not very techy, guys. Ethereum is one of the big technologies out there that's running code on the blockchain. It's very, very clever. It's massive, it's changing the world. The company behind Consensus, for instance, is one of our most epic users and contributors who are building these sorts of applications. And it shows a little bit what we're all about. We're about real-time applications. We're about synchronizing data between clients. And clients for us means browsers, smartphones, and also server-side processes, car message buses, military hardware, and even, as of late, when we were a secretive space. And that's super straightforward, actually. What we do is we have a bit of a different model. We share tiny bits of data between all these systems. Each client can create, read, update, and write this data, and every change to any kind of data is synchronized between all the latest clients within a matter of milliseconds. And we do this on speed at a massive, massive scale. And there's some very, very real-world use cases. Ticketmaster, for instance, uses it to create real-time seat maps. So when you book your next ticket, you see a map of the venue, and you see all the seats vanish before your very eyes. And of course you panic and you go, oh my god, I want this exact seat. I probably pay a premium for this. Or, give you another example, Nike's using it to create these elaborate in-store experiences. You get into a store and you have this shoe design that allows you to design the same sort of shoe with people in China and in Austria and create this kind of cumulative work. And with the fabric behind that, that synchronizes all this data. We're open for every kind of developer. You can literally sign up to a platform, try the whole thing out, and use one of our SDKs. Come on, there you go. To connect to it. And from there on, every bit of data interaction, single bit of persistence is completely managed for you. There is a very rigid endpoint to what is a very complicated data network that spans the world. Thanks so much.
For
for Java, for C, using different protocols.
Hi, I want to know, like, do your system endorse concurrency? If this is the case, concurrency on data, concurrency like multiple clients trying to write, for example, the same data at the same time?
Yes, absolutely. So we're using a system which is quite frankly a derivation of Git's approach to decentralized data syncing. Each single update committed by any given client has a hash and a version number, and there's a sophisticated merchant algorithm that can also overwrite and define yourself in place to make sure that data is merged in the right way. We also support operational transforms for more complicated documents, allowing you to basically save a history of steps in the way.
Okay, so then the next question. So if it's transactional, for example, you support operational transform, like, do you have like any kind of implementation of system environments? So any kind of constraints on the system, for example?
So operational transforms are opt-in. By default, we use a faster but more simple merchant algorithm that by if a conflict occurs, sends the conflict to the data, make it to the client and try to wipe it, and that leads to the client burn out. On the operational transform side, no, it's relatively simple. We provide built-in operation transforms and go up to, I think, 5,000 steps per day. But it's not really important to me.
Thanks.
So how much latency should we expect from this service? Is it geographically relevant?
It is. So we come from a background in trading technology, and latency has always been our given to an extent. If you use the open source server, for instance, or especially the enterprise version, the server latency is below 1 millisecond plus network latency. For the platform, it's slightly higher. Our highest platform latency is 6 milliseconds when you give a transaction, whether it's a write, read, or you can also send events or make remote procedure calls. 6 is the maximum. And on top of that, it's network latency. We host the thing in a number of data centers around the world, so given network proximity, usually below 10.
Do we have any use case for healthcare environmental applications?
No, I'm afraid not yet. We're trying to become HIPAA compliant. That's thanks for that.
Just in terms of serialization and remote protocol, remote call procedures, compared to gRPC or similar protocols such as protobuf, flat buffers, how does this compare for large payloads?
Really good question. So we're using proprietary and as of soon came to protocol, which we call deep-distributed real-time protocol. The mechanism is comparable to gRPC in a large extent. It handles local latency redistribution. If an endpoint cannot answer an RPC, it can reject it and will be rerouted to as many other endpoints until you're out of ones that can provide this game RPC. Serialization is built in. We're using a mix of binary formats on the back end and JSON based on the front end. We've looked into protobufs, we've looked into message packet and the likes, but to ensure interoperability between browsers, we're still about the core usages and backend systems, we went for JSON.
So, follow-up question is, then the DeepStream server API is instigating clients or open source, but the protocol is closed source?
Okay. No, it's open source as well. There is. In contrast, actually, so we're currently having a large initiative, which will hopefully conclude soon, to have the protocol become a completely separate entity with its own website and source them and so on, and kind of give, you know, when they differently as well, and run what's fine and safety. For the platform, it's slightly higher. Our highest platform latency is 6 milliseconds when you give a transaction, whether it's a write, read, or you can also send events or make remote procedure calls. 6 is the maximum. And on top of that, it's network latency. We host the thing in a number of data centers around the world, so given network proximity, usually below 10.
Do we have any use case for healthcare environmental applications?
No, I'm afraid not yet. We're trying to become HIPAA compliant. That's,
Thanks for that.
Just in terms of serialization and remote protocol, remote call procedures, compared to gRPC or similar protocols such as protobuf or flat buffers, how does this compare for large payloads?
Really good question. So we use a proprietary and as of soon fit into protocol, which we call deepstreamHub real-time protocol. The mechanism is comparable to gRPC in a large extent. It handles global balancing through distribution. If an endpoint cannot answer an RPC, it can reject it and will be rerouted to as many other endpoints until you're out of ones that can provide this game RPC. Serialization is built in. We're using a mix of binary forms on the back end and JSON based on the front end. We've looked into protobufs, we've looked into message packet and the likes, but to ensure interoperability between browsers, we're still about the core usages and backend systems, we went for JSON.
So, follow-up question is, then the DeepStream server API is instigating clients or open source, but the protocol is closed source?
Okay. No, it's open source as well. There is. In contrast, actually, so we're currently having a large initiative, which will hopefully conclude soon, to have the protocol become a completely separate entity with its own website and source and so on, and kind of give, you know, when different layers on the run, what's running.